thank you so much for taking the time to talk to me today. First thing I want to start with, what are some of the challenges that goes into being an athletic director that many people don't know about?
Lack of sleep, and that's caused by a lot of challenges. You know, obviously, I love the job. No 2 days are the same, and I absolutely love being around student athletes and spending time with them. Being around coaches, I love being around people who want to compete, and obviously we have a department full of student athletes and coaches who want to compete, but there's no doubt there's so much change going on across the country now with college athletics, whether it be NIL, transfer portal, conference realignment. So there's a lot of challenges, and I try to focus on a lot of the cool things that take place, and like I said, I just love being around people who want to compete and represent our institution the right way, and I feel like we do that in a good way here at Minnesota.
How has being an athletic director changed in the NIL era?
Well, you know, Ahmad, it feels like it changes almost daily. You know, like almost a year ago, I couldn't even talk to you about NIL. And now I can talk about NIL, right? And we can educate our student athletes on NIL. There was a ruling a couple weeks ago in Tennessee and Virginia by a judge where basically the NCAA can't enforce NIL rules right now. So, you know, NIL, it's constantly changing. I'm all about that. I think it's very, very important that student athletes have an opportunity to earn name, image, and likeness. I'm very grateful for Jeremiah Carter on our staff. You know, we've been working with Digitown Athletes, our collective, to work with our student athletes to try to maximize those opportunities for our student athletes. But it literally changes by the minute. You could ask me that question 20 minutes from now, and I could give you a totally different answer. But that's what makes the job interesting and leads to those sleepless nights.
Yeah, I can only imagine what goes into your job. Speaking of the NIL, do you think you guys are set up to compete with other Big Ten programs like a Michigan or Ohio State, or do you think you guys are still working to get there?
I think we're still growing. You know, you've heard me say this a lot. Doing it right in Minnesota matters. That's very, very important. We hear that loud and clear from our fans, from our supporters, and I'm really grateful for our coaches. And we've talked to our coaches. You know, we're not running a sprint. A lot of institutions ran a sprint with NIL, and we're running a marathon, and our goal is to win the race. And again, I feel like our partnership with Dingytown Athletes is very healthy. We've been very systematic and pragmatic how we've moved forward with our NIL initiatives here at Minnesota. I feel like we've stayed within the guardrails, even though there are no guardrails out there, but we keep talking about making the best long-term decisions. But at the end of the day, it's about our fans, and we've got to ask our fans to step up, and they've done a wonderful job, but we're going to need to continue to step up. You know, both our basketball programs, our women's team got finished with the Big Ten tournament last week. Our men's team tips off this week with the Big Ten basketball tournament. You know, that opens up a transfer window, that opens up the transfer portal, NIL, all those opportunities. So, again, I encourage fans to go to Dingytown Athletes, support our student athletes, and I promise you our kids are doing really good things with that.
And I feel like with the support that you're getting from the community, you're giving it back to these athletes. You help bring Athletes Village here to Minneapolis. You guys are also talking about updates to Williams Arena or possibly building a new stadium. What goes into that, and where are you guys on that process?
Yeah, well, you know, a couple things. You know, first off, when you talk about NIL, you know, I tell people all the time, if you're having a bad day, come over and eat lunch at Athletes Village, and you can spend time with our student athletes. And you've heard me talk about student athletes have a record grade point average of 3.46. Our graduation rate, I think, is a record 95-96%. So they're doing wonderful things. So when people invest in NIL, they're investing in really good kids. And then when you talk about the investments we have to make as an institution, a department for our student athletes, you know, we're so grateful for our fans that helped us out with Athletes Village. It's a $190 million facility, which, you know, has academic services, athletic services, nutrition, mental health, all those things which benefit our student athletes tremendously. And you touched on Williams Arena. You know, obviously Williams Arena has great history. We recognize that great history. We're working with campus right now. We've had a handful of meetings with an outside consultant. We just want to see what we can do with Williams Arena. What's possible, what's not possible, what does the cost look like, those type of things. And as we gather more information, we'll work closely with, obviously we have President Edinger here, who's our interim president, and then President Cunningham, who will start, I believe this summer, we'll start to have those conversations with her, and we'll work closely with our campus partners. But we do need to take a look at Williams Arena. We're not tearing it down. You know, I think, you know, the media sometimes runs out there and says, oh my gosh, we're tearing it down and building a new arena. None of those decisions have been made, and I promise you we'll have a transparent process where we want people to give us feedback, to have involvement, because again, we want to make sure we respect what Williams Arena is and continue to celebrate that great facility.
If I had to ask, do you think it's a benefit to this campus by keeping Williams Arena?
Well, you know, it's got such great history and tradition. At the same time, you know, I think our you know, winning, what we do at this level, winning is super important, right? And Williams Arena, we're in the business of recruiting 18-year-old kids to say yes to Minnesota. And they are overwhelmed by the wow factor. And so, like, when you walk into Athletes Village, you say, wow, right? When you walk into Williams Arena, it's a great facility, great history, great tradition. We need to create more of a wow factor with that facility. And I think if you look at the locker room spaces underneath the court that a lot of our fans can't see, we've done a wonderful job there making that a wow factor. So again, when we look at Williams Arena moving forward, how do we add to the wow factor to get those 18-year-old kids to say yes to Minnesota?
And speaking of wow factors, winning has a lot to do with that on the court. Last season, you made a very difficult decision by parting ways with Lindsey Whalen. It was met with a lot of backlash from the community. Now we're here a year later. Coach Plitzer-White came in, almost took this team to the NCAA tournament. When you make a decision like that to let go of Coach Whalen, what goes into a decision like that, and how do you handle the backlash from the community?
Well, I think the first thing, you know, I'm the least confrontational person in America. I mean, ask my wife. I've never won an argument, right? And so what I've learned is, you know, we try to have open and honest conversations. And I'm hopeful that if you talk to our coaches, you know, we talk to our coaches every day about four or five things that we want to focus on. We talk about compliance. We have to do things the right way. We talk about the student-athlete experience. Are our student-athletes having a good experience here at Minnesota? And when our student-athletes go through our program, we will do interviews with our student-athletes. We'll do exit interviews with them. Our student-athletes get feedback on that experience. We talk about the fundraising and the vibe around the program and those type of things. And then the last thing we talk about is winning. And at this level, good, bad, or indifferent, winning matters. And quite honestly, I wish we won more, right? You know, I'm addicted to winning. It's fun to win. It's fun to be a part of those great championship programs. And so when we have to make difficult decisions, you always want to make the best long-term decision for the institution. We're super excited about Dawn being here. As you said, we were having a great, great season. We had a couple injuries tomorrow to Sophie that got us off track a little bit, but we're still looking for some postseason opportunities, and I know we'll continue to work hard and build that program and go in the right direction.
Speaking of the men, they have been down the past couple of years, but they're turning things around right now. What do you have to say about Ben Johnson and what he's been able to do?
Yeah, well, you know, I give Ben a lot of credit because those same expectations that I just outlined to you, Ben knows that, and he knows that winning matters at this level. And I think we're a much more competitive team. We kind of struggled down the stretch here these last two games against Indiana at home and against Northwestern, but we have a great opportunity on Thursday in the Big Ten basketball tournament playing a really good Michigan State team who we split with. I hope our fans show up. It's an 11 a.m. tip, an early tip off, but we need people there to support our program. But again, Ben is taking this program in the right direction. You know, I think people sometimes forget, and I get patience is a four-letter word. I mean, I totally understand that, but we had one student athlete return from the team when we made our coaching transition, right? So this has been a complete rebuild, and I give him a lot of credit. He's brought in really, really good young men. He's recruiting really good young men who want to compete for us, and I really like the vibe around our program and just really grateful for Ben and how he's leading our program.
Well, speaking of those two coaches, you had to bring in a new one in Dawn. Ben was able to be retained, but John Anderson is going to be taking a step back and leaving Gophers baseball. How hard is it to fill a job like that with all the success Anderson has had?
Well, you know, John is the one constant around this program. I mean, almost 50 years involved with this program. He's somebody who I lean on and talk to get advice and counsel on many different topics, not just baseball. And our goal this year is we want to celebrate John. We want to celebrate the wonderful career he's had as a student athlete, you know, as the head coach and what he's done, the all-time winning Big Ten coach, those type of things. And so, you know, there's going to be a big void when he leaves, and we're going to miss him. I've told John, hey, you may be stepping away from coaching our baseball program, but you're always welcome here. You're always going to be visible, be around our program, because he has seen it all, and he can teach all of us so much about what it means to be a Minnesota, you know, represent this great institution, represent this great department, those type of things. So there's no doubt we're going to celebrate him this year, but we look forward to the opportunity to hire a new baseball coach to lead that program. But again, those are big shoes to fill, and it's a lot of pressure on us to find the right person to carry that program forward.
Where are you in that progress? Have you started any interviews?
We haven't started any interviews, Ahmad. We've actually posted the position. So we've got the position posted. Peyton Owens, who's our senior associate athletics director and our sport administrator for baseball, will head up that search. We actually had a search committee meeting late last week where we just got an update. We are starting to get some people who are applying for the job. We're taking inbound calls from different coaches around the country. We're listening to Coach Anderson and others on people that we need to look at, those type of things. So we're just starting the process. And as I just mentioned, we want to make sure we focus on this year's team. We focus on John. And as we get towards the end of the season, obviously the people we're looking at are coaching different programs, and we want to make sure we're respectful of their programs. And as things wind down towards the end of the season, we'll start to move very quickly and get the next person in charge here.
Okay. And last two topics I want to talk to you about, the changing of the Big Ten and the expansion with the new teams coming in. What does this mean for recruiting in Minnesota, and what does this mean for Minnesota athletics in the next 10 years?
Well, you know, I tell people I had a chance. I spoke with the Board of Regents this past week. We were doing a contract amendment for PJ, and I talked about the importance of being in the Big Ten. I mean, when you talk about the Big Ten, and then you add four great institutions like USC, UCLA, Oregon, and Washington. And if you just think for a second what those programs do athletically and then academically, I mean, those are four big-time additions to the Big Ten Conference. And so I think it only enhances our brand, our recognition across the country. And when we talk to student-athletes, you know, we talk all the time about competing at the highest level. And again, when you look at those four schools and our current Big Ten members, from top to bottom, there's some phenomenal athletic programs. So whether you're a swimming or diving student-athlete, you're a baseball player, a softball player, a hockey player, a football player, you're going to compete against the best of the best. And so I think that's definitely been a huge help for us as we go on moving forward with our recruiting process.
You talked about amending the contract for PJ and wanting to make sure that we're still in the Big Ten. Why was that important for you to extend him and make sure that he has some retention clauses in his contract to make sure he's not going anywhere else?
Yeah, well, you know, people chase him every year, you know, and we totally get 6-7 last year, not the expectations. You know, we want to obviously have more wins, but if you look at what he's done during his time here, I think he's the fifth fastest 50 wins in program history. We have our highest grade point averages we've ever had. He's won five straight bowl games. If you look at the type of young men he's brought into our program, they've been awesome people, awesome representatives of Minnesota. And again, people are chasing him every year, and there was real interest this year, and I felt like I was important, and I'm grateful for President Enger. I'm grateful for our board leadership because they recognize the value of PJ and what he means to this institution. And again, whether he's speaking at Minnesota commencement, he's teaching a class in the Carlson School of Management, the dude is everywhere. And he and Heather, I mean, I didn't even talk about what they do with the Children's Hospital. I mean, he and Heather have been the ultimate change agents. And selfishly, we want him here for a long time. He's a great, great fit for Minnesota. And selfishly for me, he's a great fit. I really enjoyed working with him and spending time around him and Heather.
Well, I'll ask you a question that I asked PJ last year at Big Ten Media Days when we were in Indianapolis. It's not easy to win 9 games in a season, and he did that several seasons in a row. When do you take this program from good to great? Because when PJ came here, he said he wanted to not only compete for Big Ten championships, but national championships. And in his time here, he is 21-2 in non-conference, 29-32 in conference, 1-6 versus Iowa, and 0-4 versus Michigan and Ohio State. How do you approach him about taking this program to the elite team that he talks about?
Hey. It's every conversation we have, and that's why I love him being here, because when I was hired by President Kaler almost 8 years ago, I guess it was 8 years ago this time period, and when I was hired by President Kaler, I made it very, very clear, I do not want to be 500. I did not come here to be 500. I worked at Minnesota from 2001 to 2005. I feel like this is an untapped institution in terms of athletic success, and I promise you, PJ and I scratch every day on how to get better, and at the end of the day, it comes down to recruiting and developing the student athletes. And if you look at our recruiting classes in football over the past several years, they've been some of our highest recruiting classes we've ever had. And again, academically, off the charts, doing great things. But again, I talk about those four or five things. Winning's a big part of that. And I have a lot of respect. You know, I always try to clarify this because people get mad at me when I say this, but I have a lot of respect for Wisconsin. You know, when I was growing up, Wisconsin was a laughingstock of the Big Ten. They were not very good at all in some of the revenue sports. And if you look at Wisconsin today and what Coach Alvarez did with their football program, how they built that the right way, I look at the University of Iowa. Doesn't mean I like them. I respect them, right? And we have to do everything we can to put Minnesota in that position where we have everything lined up and we win the games that we have to win. And at the end of the day, if you win games, you put yourself in a special situation. And if you go back to that Outback Bowl we played a few years ago beating Auburn, we beat Penn State that year. We had some big-time wins, and that's addicting. I want to get back there. I know PJ wants to get back there, and it's on us to make those hard decisions to make sure we achieve at the highest level.
Now I will say this. A lot of people want to know, with the contracts, we know with college coaching, anything can change any given time. Does that contract with PJ have him here through 2029 guaranteed, or does he have to go out there and prove his job every single year?
Well, I think we're all evaluated every day. I mean, that's just part of the process. And again, selfishly, I love working with PJ. I love being around he and Heather. And again, I call them the ultimate change agents, what they've done with our program. But every day, we're all evaluated. You asked me a question earlier about when we went through a coaching. I'm evaluated every day. And again, it's what I love about what I do for a living, right? You've got to show up. You have to have a sense of urgency every day. We talk about that inside our department. And I think PJ has that sense of urgency. You've been around him. He can't sit still. He wants to win. He wants to go at the highest level. Ben, Don, Bob Motzko, you know, Brad Frost, Keegan Cook, Piper Ritter, Jenny Hansen, all of our coaches have that sense of urgency where they want to compete at the highest level, and that's what I love about what I do and being here. But again, our coaches, we're evaluated every day. We realize how we're evaluated, and that's why we do what we do.
And you're building a new gymnastics complex right over here by AV. Can you talk about why that's important for that team?
Well, super excited for Jenny Hansen. I mean, Jenny has been, you know, as a former student athlete in and out as an assistant coach, and she became our head coach. Two of the past 3 years, we finished in the top eight in the country. She has done an unbelievable job. We actually break ground, I think, in the next week or so with a new $15 million gymnastics practice facility, which is going to be awesome for them, and just excited for him. They've earned it, and excited for Jenny. She has fought so hard for that the right way. She's competed at a high level, and in a lot of ways, her program is a benchmark for other programs because she's having that national success. And this will be another piece of that puzzle to help her with the recruiting to create that wow factor that we talked about earlier.
And where does this program, where does this university go from here, Mark? Where do you hope to leave this university whenever you do get done being the athletic director here?
Well, I had a chance. My first AD job was at Boise State, and I had a chance to work with Chris Peterson, their football coach, who was ultra, ultra successful, went on to Washington, and now actually teaches in the business school at Washington. And you know, Chris taught me all the time, it's your job to leave it better than you found it. And my goal is to leave this place better than we found it. And I feel like we have a lot of opportunity for growth. We want to continue to make smart decisions. We want to represent this institution, the state, the right way. But I'm telling you, when I was at Kentucky, I was at Syracuse, and you go to a Final Four. When I was at Boise State and I play in the Fiesta Bowl, that stuff's addicting. I want to be at that level. I want our student athletes to experience that. And there's no reason why we can't do those special things here at Minnesota. So we'll give every ounce of energy we have to get us to those next levels.
Appreciate your time.
All right, man. Thank you.
Thank you so much.